Welcome to Modelesque Mindset travel tips and tricks. So a lot of models do travel for their jobs. They travel out of the market that they are currently in. Maybe it's out of city, out of state, or even out of the country. You are always going to need your model bag. We have talked about this many, many times before. You are very familiar with this list. Put as much as you need or as little as you need, but I think that when traveling, you will need literally every single thing on this list that applies to you because you are not going to be in your home. And if you need these things last minute, you may not have the time to go get it. There may not be a place to go get it. You will be surprised how many small cities you are going to, and it's going to cost you a bunch of money. So when you are packing, you want to think ahead. Write out a checklist. Think about what you're going to be doing. How many days are you there for? What is your job? Utilize packing cubes for your wardrobe. Utilize organizer bags for things like hair and makeup and toiletries. And clean out the entire bag before you start packing. First, to make sure there's no like bugs or old food, but also to make sure that you don't end up packing something that is going to get you pulled over by security if you are traveling through TSA. Also, you want to bring heels. Almost always, you just should be carrying a pair. Get a light, strappy pair or a pump that you can take with you and pack easily. No wedges, no nail tips. You want a 3 to 5 inch heel. Easy to get on and off, a nude black or non-distracting color, and heels that you can walk in like a pro. You may have a last minute casting, you may need to do a self-tape. Bringing heels is always a good idea. When you are off duty, what should you wear? Well, you can wear whatever you want at the end of the day, but I suggest wearing something that fits you well, is clean and taken care of. Avoid extra baggy clothing. Be careful with open pockets. If you are traveling, things can fall out of those pockets. Maybe choose things with zippers or don't put things in your pockets when traveling. You'll be surprised how many people lose things when they sit down in a train seat or an airplane seat. It's a little bit different than sitting down in your car. Sometimes you scooch down and try and get real comfortable and things fall out. You want to bring your jewelry in a bag and wait to put it on until after you get through TSA. Otherwise, you have to stand there and try and take it all off, and then you're getting stressed because everybody's waiting on you and it may get lost. You want to bring or wear socks to go through TSA. You do not know the last time that floor has been cleaned, and a million people have already walked over it, even if it has been cleaned recently. So wearing socks can prevent you from getting any type of infection on the bottom of your feet when headed to a job, which is literally the worst time. Here are some more outfit options. Wear what's going to make you comfortable, what you're going to feel good in. But if you wear something that still looks presentable, this is a good idea because you may be landing and going straight to the job, or you may be seeing the client at the hotel that you are checking into if you are checking in the night before. And this allows you to just look polished and professional, just like as if you were kind of going to a casting. Now, you don't have to be in heels. You don't have to be super dressed up about it, but just don't look like you rolled out of bed. Try wearing black on black. It's always easy. And then that way you already have it if you have a last minute casting on your way home or anything. Leggings or pants, shorts or skirts, if you're okay with that. I get cold with traveling, so I always wear pants or a long dress. And if you want, of course, you could wear a mini dress. You want it to be easy to get on and off and easy to walk in. When you get there and you're changing, you want it to be easy to get on and off if you're going straight to that job, and easy to walk in because you might be walking around a lot in these airport terminals. Unless, of course, you are driving there, then this can change what you're wearing. When you are going out of city or out of state on a plane, you need to keep everything in your carry-on luggage. When you land, you are supposed to get straight to the transportation area. They don't want to wait for you to wait, you know, 30 minutes, even up to an hour or more for your bags. Most clients require and even explicitly state that you are not to check your bag. They paid for your flight. They do get to make rules about these things. They want you to carry on your luggage. Plus, you also want to make sure those things are with you because sometimes luggage can just get lost or misplaced. And if you don't have anything and you've just landed and you're headed to your job, that can really ruin your day. You want to try and arrive 2.5 to 3 hours before your flight. If you are late and you miss your flight, the client can charge you for that flight and just cancel you, or they could buy you a new flight and charge you for that new flight and for the flight that you missed. So you would end up paying for two flights. Or like sometimes they'll just charge you for the last one that you missed and they'll pay for the new one because originally they were going to pay for one of them anyways. But that new flight might be super expensive because it's last minute. And I've seen models get charged for these things, and I've seen models tell themselves like, oh no, I'm going to leave 2 hours before. And then it takes them an hour to get there with traffic, and then TSA is crazy, and then they miss their flight. And it's just not worth it. I know it can seem boring. It can seem crazy to go a little early, but your agents will appreciate it. It will help if you are missing flights. One time I went early and my flight was being delayed, but the flight before it had seats on it. And I went up to the TSA, the flight people, like the Delta people. And I was like, hey, I need to get to work. Is there any way, like, what do I do about this missed plane? And they're like, oh, we have one that's literally boarding and it's leaving in like 10 minutes. Go run to that gate and we'll get you on it. And I was able to get on the earlier flight and still make it to my job on time because I was there early. So it's benefited me many times. I highly suggest going early. You never know with traffic and TSA. And just take a book or take a nap or take your phone and do something or eat something. But being there early will make sure that you get to your job on time and don't get charged or canceled. When it comes to delays, you do want to email your rep or the client. If you are running late to the airport or train, if your flight or train takeoff has been delayed, and in-air on-track delays if you have the service to send it. You want to keep it short and sweet. It's just about sort of keeping them updated. It's not a whole conversation. So you would just send an email to the agent or the client saying, my flight is currently delayed by 2 hours. I will continue to update you. And that's it. Because you don't really have any more information, but they need to know, because like I said, sometimes you're landing and going straight to the job, or they have arranged transportation for you. And this way they can make sure you are still going to have transportation when you land later, that you're still going to be checked into your hotel and they know you're coming later, or whatever the situation is if you're going straight to the job. You can speed things up at TSA with Clear. Clear is something you have to purchase. It's $179 a year. There are some discounts to it. I'll look into getting a discount code for you guys. This allows you to bypass the lines and the license check, and you get to go straight to the bins. They check your identity and you show some documents. They do a background check. They like scan your eyeballs and your fingerprints. And then every time that you go to an airport that has Clear, you scan either your eyeball or your fingerprints, and a Clear person will walk you up past the TSA person who checks the license and puts you at the front of the line for the bins. So that can really save you a dramatic amount of time if you would like to spend that money. It's also potentially a write-off. For TSA PreCheck, you get to keep your coats and shoes on. You get to leave your laptop and liquids in your carry-on. So that can save you a lot of just headache and potentially losing things when you're trying to take all these things off and put them into all these extra bins. It costs $85 for 5 years, and that helps you with the physical screening process. Also, there is global entry. They use a kiosk instead of filling out all of the paperwork and interviewing with an agent. It costs $100 for 5 years and also gives you PreCheck. So if you are only going to be traveling within the United States, PreCheck is plenty. But if you are going to go international, you could choose global entry and not get PreCheck, because global entry will give you PreCheck with the purchase of the $100 for 5 years. And that helps you with interviews and forms. So all three of these can help you to get through the airports faster. And Clear also helps you get through like games of like sports, basketball, baseball, starting to have them, concerts are starting to have them. So it could work for you outside of the airport as well, just for like your personal life stuff. If you are going to sleep at the airport, maybe your flight is delayed, maybe you're super early, you want to sleep at the gate. If you sleep away from the gate, people are not going to wake you up or care, and you may miss your flight. You want to keep belongings packed and near you. You want to set an alarm for about 25 minutes before your scheduled departure time, because they do close those doors. I would, in fact, even say sooner. It says doors close 15 minutes prior to departure, but I feel like they're starting to close them earlier and earlier now, even like 30 minutes prior to departure. The airlines are constantly changing their guidelines and their rules. This is something that they get to make up, so it is subject to be changed at any time. And just always check with your airline, but do set an alarm to make sure you do not miss that flight. When you land, I don't know why it says you are, sorry about that. Turn on your phone, double check that you have everything. Look in your seat, do not walk away. It is worth the extra 15 seconds it's going to take you to check, because if you do get off that plane, they cannot let you back on the plane. And sometimes the plane is already being cleaned as you're getting off to be turned around, or they're moving the plane to another gate, and you may not be able to go get back on and get your stuff, and it may take off to another city. I've had it personally happen to me, and I've known several other models who have lost things because they just didn't realize it was there, and then it was too late by the time they got to baggage check and realized it. So go ahead and double check and use the restroom. Try to go to the restroom that is a little bit away from your gate. Most people go to the first restroom or the second restroom. If you try and walk to maybe the third or the fourth, you will probably have no lines. And you want to find your transport and head straight to the booking. You don't want to hang around. You don't want to get in line, a long line for food. If you really have no food and no snacks and you didn't plan ahead, you can maybe try and get some food, but if you're sitting there for like half an hour in a line waiting for some food, they are going to get annoyed at you. They have the transport waiting for you. Again, you're not supposed to be checking your bag, so they shouldn't be waiting for you for more than maybe 20 minutes that it takes to go to the bathroom and walk to the transport. Getting to the booking. There may be client transport. When we go in groups, they usually get a bus for us or some type of transportation. They may be having you take a taxi, which could either be potentially a write-off, or you're getting a receipt and giving it to that client for reimbursement. Or if they have approved your personal transport, please do not just go have your friends or your family, if they're in that town, come pick you up without letting the client know, because they are going to be doing a head count. They are going to think you have gotten lost. They are going to worry. They are going to be sitting there wasting time looking for you. Make sure someone knows. That's what I mean when I say approved. Like, of course, if you want to go in your own car, they're probably going to let you. They don't own you, but they need to know where you are. They are paying for you and your time. They are flying you in. They're even usually paying you on your day off. So you're technically at work. Make sure you are communicating. With your accommodations, if you are staying overnight, it may be a single occupancy. It may be a double occupancy, typically somebody of the same gender as you. It may be you are staying in a model apartment. There could also be an Airbnb, single or multiple occupancy. And then, of course, approved personal accommodations. Again, when I say approved, I mean that you are letting them know where you are going to be. They most likely aren't going to say no or argue with you. They do not own you. But when it comes to you being flown in for a job, you are not on vacation. You don't get to go out and party all night and then show up drunk or hungover to the booking. And also, they need to know that you have reliable transportation and you are actually going to make it back to the booking on time. There are a lot of jobs that happen in Vegas, and when models go from LA to Vegas, sometimes they'll want to stay on their own. And some clients literally write in the booking agreement that you cannot stay on your own because they have had too many models end up going out and partying all night, or they go visit their family and then they come in late to the strip. They don't think about traffic, and then they're late to the job. So in those kinds of situations, that's what I'm talking about approved. These people are paying for your time, your flight, your hotel. They get to have somewhat of a say in you showing up to the job on time. When it comes to model apartments, those are typically charged to your account. So if you are traveling to go be in Miami for a few months and you live in New York or LA, you are going to most likely stay in a model apartment. They will charge you either daily, weekly, or monthly, depending on how long you're staying. You might be visiting for fashion week and not want to get a hotel or not be able to find one that you like. So you may be staying in a model apartment in that kind of situation. Also, they sometimes they're cheaper than hotels, sometimes they're not. Up to 4 models per room. Yes, a lot of model apartments are bunk beds. They are not luxurious most of the time. They could be well stocked or not. Some are super amazing. They've got pots and pans and dishes and everything, and it's super nice and clean, and there's even maids. And some are not. They're bare minimum basics. They got a few things, maybe one random fork and spoon. So you just got to figure out what your agency provides. Also, it could have amenities or not. It could have a gym. It could have a pool. It may not have any of these things. This is going to depend not only on your agency, but most agencies have multiple model apartments. And then during their high time, like fashion week, they'll even rent out extra ones that they don't normally rent out. So they may not even be doing a lot of research into what these apartments have or how much they have. They just need somewhere for their models to stay for fashion week. So they may not be the best places. They're not always the prettiest and cleanest. So you do want to try and get as much information about a model apartment as possible before you move in case you need to bring things like sheets or silverware or any of that stuff. Then there's things like add-on expenses. When traveling, you may be getting a per diem. That is an amount of money they give you per day to pay for meals and snacks. They may be giving you certain meals. So they may say, okay, well, we're going to give you breakfast and lunch, but you can get dinner every night and we'll give you $30 a night for dinner as credit. So you could spend up to $30 and they would reimburse you. Everything past $30, they would not reimburse you. Also things like taxis, trains, and planes, they may be paying for these things. Most clients do pay for these things, but some clients do not pay for these things. That would be known before the booking. Also, your travel day rate. Typically, that is half of the day rate you are getting for the job. Not all clients pay the travel day rate, but typically when they do, that will be any time that you are traveling and unable to work. So if you are traveling on Monday, shooting Tuesday, Wednesday, and then traveling back home on Thursday, you would get paid Monday and Thursday half of your day rate. A guarantee. So if you are going to another country, there are things called guarantee contracts. That is with an agency saying that they believe you will make at least that amount of money in a specified time frame. The time frame can be 6 weeks to 6 months. The contract typically also includes agreed to fees for things like your phone. Because you're going to this other country, they may be giving you a phone that works in that country. Book and cards, you are going to be given a new book, whether you have one or not. They are going to give you a book that comes from their agency. The cards they print, the transportation. A lot of times you have a driver in these other countries because you don't know where you're going and legally you can't drive. So they will transport you, or you may be taking the subway or something and they may have gotten you your pass already, so that way you have it the second you land. So you'd be paying back for that. Also, maybe your city maps, Hong Kong, they gave me a map when I landed and I had to pay for it. Your accommodations, like your model apartment, and also pocket money. And that's where they give you about $100 US in whatever currency. So for me, it was equal to $100 in the United States, but it was whatever number came out in the exchange rate in that country. And it was weekly. And I didn't have to pay it back, but I knew models who did have to pay it back. But it was supposed to help you to not have to go to the bank, to not have to get cash every week, and to not have to deal with really high exchange rates because you look like a foreigner and they're getting it more from like their bank. So they'd get really low exchange rates for you, which was really good. And that would give you money to get around for the week, to get food for the week. And like I said, some people paid it back and some people did not. So if you go to a country on a guarantee contract and you do not book a set amount of jobs in a set amount of days, say 10 jobs in 15 days or 15 castings, the agency will eat the cost of flying you out and setting you up and they will send you home. So whatever cards they printed for you, whatever transportation, they're going to eat all of that cost typically. And they send you home because it is their fault that they did not know their market. They said to you, hey, come to our country. We think you will work. And then you got there and you didn't. So they say, hey, our bad, go home, free trip. And it's not the worst thing in the world. It can feel very disappointing, but it just means it wasn't the right fit. It may not be the right time. There may be some economic factors going on, but that's the basics of foreign contracts. And also, there is no guarantee of work or pay. They may bill you or they may eat costs for those setup and accommodation. So these are when you do not have that contract. So on these ones, you have this guarantee that says if you come out here and you don't work, we'll eat the cost. There are some contracts that do not guarantee that. I would not suggest going on those contracts. That means they don't even believe in you enough to put on the line about $1,000. Then you might not work in that country. It might work out, but you're taking a big risk. So only do that if you have the budget and financial stability to do that. Some more things you should know about foreign travel are visas. The agencies may do all of the work or you may have to do it. Each country is different. If you are coming from another country to the United States, they do not typically help you that much with your visas. If you are going from the United States to another country, they do typically help you with your visas. They are typically temporary working visas, whereas people coming to the US tend to be looking for more long-term working visas. Whereas, like I said, when you're going overseas from the US, it's typically more of like a 6 week to a 6 month contract. So they are willing to help you get those types of visas. And it will maybe be charged on your account, maybe not. Again, depends on your contracts. You want to register with the NBC. It is called STEP, Smart Traveler Enrollment Program. It's free and it can help you in crises and natural disasters. So that way they know that you're in another country. If anything happens, they know that you as a citizen are there and your embassy can help you. Phone plans and apps you want to look up before you go and change your phone plan to avoid crazy international charges and download some apps that have free messaging or video. When I lived overseas, I took an iPod Touch, which was still popular at the time, and I downloaded some free apps like Skype and WhatsApp, and I was able to use those on Wi-Fi. The countries I lived in had a lot of free Wi-Fi basically everywhere. Like, you're just walking down the street and there's free Wi-Fi. And I was able to send messages and Skype people. I was even able to Skype my agents, like not with the video. There's like a phone function on it. So now there's even way more apps and way more things that you can use and services. So go ahead and look into those free messaging apps. If you want me to make a list, let me know. A passport is essential for foreign travel. You want to print a paper copy so you have it for emergencies in case anything happens. And also save a PDF or JPEG version on your phone, again, in case anything happens. Do not give your passport to your agents. Just make up an excuse and don't give it to them. I had agents try and take my passport in China because they were trying to keep me in the country. And they are shady about it. Do not give it to them. Nobody should be holding your passport. It's yours. Don't let them do that. Also, keep it somewhere safe. It is very important. It is the most important thing you are carrying when you are traveling as a foreigner. Also, there are money countries versus tear countries. So some countries will make you tens of thousands of dollars and some will get you amazing editorials and covers. There are very few that will do both and you want to plan accordingly. So you want to, if you can, maybe go to a money country and then go to a tear country where you can live off the money from the money country and then go back to the money country. So that way you can take your tears and be waiting for those to all roll in, because even though you shoot them, it sometimes takes a few weeks or months for it to come out. You can make some more money in the money country. And then when you go home, you have that money to live off of until you start working at home again, because you got all this awesome experience and these new tears. So you're gonna start working. But even if you start working the day you get home, it takes a few months to get paid by most United States agencies. So by going money tear, money home, you can help your financial stability a lot. Of course, you do not have to do that work. Do whatever works best for you, because everything in the modeling industry is a case-by-case basis. For me, South Korea was a money country. I did not go to Thailand, but it was a tear country. That's why I didn't go. I was money focused at the time. And I went to Hong Kong and made a lot of money. China, you make a lot of money, but I didn't like how they treated me, so I left. If you were to go somewhere like Paris or Italy, Milan, those countries tend to be more about getting big name works, doing runway shows and fashion week, and getting tears. You don't really make a lot of money. They take a lot of taxes. And if you are a US citizen, you have to pay taxes in the country you work, and you have to pay taxes in the US. It is a United States thing. They do it to everyone, not just models. You have to pay taxes in both countries, and you got to pay commission, and then you get what's left. So you tend not to make money in those countries, and you should be prepared for that. Ask questions from your agents so you are prepared for how much money you are not going to make. Again, we talked about those applications that you should download. Things like Metro Maps, train ticket apps, and language travel apps are all other good ideas that I wanted to mention. I've used language apps to learn the basics and be able to at least say hello and thank you. People will really appreciate that and treat you better if you show them some respect by trying to learn a little bit of their language. Those train ticket apps can help you from losing a paper ticket and being able to prove it in case anybody checks your ticket while you're riding. It can help you to buy it early. So when you're on the run, when you're on the go to castings and stuff, you can buy those train ticket apps on the phone before you even get to the station. And that can help you from having to stand in line and make sure that you actually get a ticket. And Metro Maps are really helpful. There are so many free apps to help you get around whatever city you are traveling to. That's everything for travel tips and tricks. If you feel I have missed anything or want me to elaborate, please comment below. As always, I would love to hear if this is changing things for you, if it's helping you. Please email me that or post on social media using the hashtag Modelesque Mindset. And as always, if you would like to book a one-on-one, the link is provided.